Introduce the American to the men.
Very well. This is Chevalier, Montage, Détente, Avant-Garde, and Déjà Vu.
Have we not met before, monsieur?
I don't think so.
Over there, Poisson. Soufflé, escargot, and chocolate mousse.
Members of the French Underground in Top Secret, the new satirical comedy from the makers of Airplane. And that's one of the new movies we're going to be reviewing this week on At the Movies. Joining me here in the balcony is Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune.
And across the aisle from me, Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times. In addition to Top Secret, we'll also be reviewing Under the Volcano, starring Albert Finney, and the story of one long day in the life of an alcoholic. Also, a special X-ray segment at the end of the show on the proposed new movie rating system. But first, Roger begins with the second Conan adventure movie called Conan the Destroyer.
Well, the basic approach in Conan is a little different this time than it was in the first Conan movie. The last time, Conan lived in a brooding, murky, prehistoric universe. But in Conan the Destroyer, he seems to have been transported into more of a standard sword and sorcery universe with savage witches and an innocent princess and a mysterious key that unlocks an ancient secret. It's a quest movie, and on his quest, Conan comes across a woman warrior who's tied to a stake. The warrior is played by the famous rock star Grace Jones.
Conan, there are six of them against him.
One, two, three. I think you're right.
She's tied to the stake. Do something.
Like she's enjoying herself. That was Arnold Schwarzenegger, of course, as Conan the Barbarian. And Grace Jones, after she wins against those enemies of hers, joins his hardy band, along with Wilt Chamberlain, who plays the commander of the Palace Guard. He's kind of a turncoat who has an agenda of his own. And they enter the glass fortress of an evil wizard. And in this scene, the wizard turns into a monster that Conan must destroy. This is an interesting idea. Every time Conan slashes a mirror, the monster bleeds. Mm-hmm.
There are only two left, Wizard. And you're behind one of them. Which one?
I like all of his supporters there telling him which one to throw it at. It's just kind of like The Price is Right for prehistory.
But, you know, that scene doesn't make any sense if you think about it. Right. Saying, well, obviously, they can duck. I mean, they have time to duck, so he throws one through theirs. And then if he's wrong, he throws it through the other guy. The other guy's just sitting around waiting.
No, that doesn't work that way because in magic, the guy has to take it through the heart if it's the right mirror. That's the rules, Gene. I thought you'd understand things like that.
Yeah, but he has plenty of time to take it through the heart.
No, but a monster doesn't. The monster doesn't take his time. The monster has to accept his fate, because that's the role of monsters in life. I actually like Conan the Destroyer better than Conan the Barbarian, the first movie. I think the filmmakers had a better idea this time of what they were going after, and one of the things they wanted was more fantasy and adventure and less bloodshed and less violence. This second Conan movie is just as exciting as the first one, but it has a lighter touch. It's more like a sword and sorcery movie and less like Rocky meets The Quest for Fire. I liked it, and I think on the basis of this one, Conan can settle in and become a successful series.
I didn't like this one as much as the first one. It's okay. That's just okay. Well, I liked the first one better was because he had a relationship with a woman that really, I think, amplified the whole series, having it rely on him doing stunts. Mm-hmm. And that was that Queen Valeria, played by the Broadway dancer Sandel Bergman. Mm-hmm. She died, and she's not coming back in the second one. And he has this Grace Jones, who, instead of being a supporting player, she's so very good in this film. Every time she's on screen, I wish they had had a relationship, but I have a feeling... hard charge to make, but I have a feeling they didn't want to have a black and white relationship, love relationship on screen, and so it never happened. And I think it would be a better movie if it had. And I hope if they have another one, that he has a big relationship with her. She's great.
Well, you're probably right about that, but I think you're wrong about the movie in general, because I think this movie is more the sort of Conan movie that people are expecting. The first one, which was R-rated, got a lot of protest from parents whose kids went to see it and who found it to be extremely gruesome and extremely bloody, and it basically is just a movie comic book, so that this second film, I think, has found the groove. And they found a way to bring out the humor in Conan, the fact that he's afraid of magic, the fact that he's a little bit simple-minded, and yet he's got this great heart and this great spirit. So I thought it was fun. I liked it.
Yeah, I thought that it was pretty much just nonstop action, and I wanted a little personal relationship, which I didn't feel the film had. Coming up next at the movies, the latest comedy from the folks who made Airplane. This film is called Top Secret, and it's the latest movie parody from the three young filmmakers who made the surprise hit Airplane a couple of years ago. Airplane kidded the disaster movie so very well, and Top Secret makes fun of two different kinds of film, the Nazi wartime story and the rock and roll teen idol movie. The combination turns out to be sort of Elvis Presley goes to East Berlin. The story here is that a young American rock star is on tour in East Berlin, and a bunch of neo-Nazis are trying to embarrass him. In this scene, the rock star has just rescued a pretty young woman from the East German police.
Thank you. That was very kind of you.
My pleasure. I was looking for someone to dance with.
You're an American.
That's right.
My uncle was born in America.
Oh, really?
But he was one of the lucky ones. He managed to escape in a balloon during the Jimmy Carter presidency.
I bet he's got a lot of great stories.
Yes. He would tell me about all the large houses and expensive cars, and how the young people waste their time watching television and listening to rock and roll music.
What's wrong with television?
Not all television. MASH was okay, and the old Mary Tyler Moore show. It just seems like the young people of America take their freedom for granted.
Now, wait a minute. I don't think you're being fair. You know, my history class won't spend an entire week in Philadelphia.
Maybe so. You can talk about freedom all you want, but still... you don't know what it's like to have to fight for it.
Also under pressure from the East Germans is Omar Sharif, a resistance fighter, just like that woman. And when Omar Sharif tries to make a contact that will help him locate that young woman's father, Top Secret delivers one of its very best sight gags.
Driver, why are we stopped here? This isn't the Howard Johnson's. I was staying at the Howard Johnson's.
A great scene. Top Secret probably consists of 100 gags or more. I guess that about 20 made me smile, and maybe 5 made me really laugh out loud, and that's much better than most comedies. But what this film is missing, I think, is any kind of coherent story. It is constantly flipping back and forth between its espionage story and that rock and roller Val Kilmer singing a bunch of his hits. That split personality suggests that this film may have been made by a computer, featuring parody for adults and pop music for the kids in the audience. That's too bad, because Top Secret is an okay comedy as it is, but it would have been so much better if they had just stayed with one film or the other. So it only gets a marginal thumbs up from me.
It gets a big thumbs up from me. You only laughed really loudly 5 times.
About
I must have
that.
Laughed really loudly 20 times. Mm-hmm. And I'll take you to see it again, and I'll explain some of the jokes.
Okay,
to you.
Thank you.
Because after all, Gene, first of all, on Conan, you want a meaningful relationship.
Yes.
Now on Top Secret, you want a better story. This is the summer. This is not autumn yet, you know.
I don't change my standards according to the calendar.
Well, I think what you're missing on this picture is that a coherent story is totally pointless in a movie that is totally made up out of one-liner sight gags and blackouts.
Oh.
This movie is utterly silly. It's not really a spy movie, so it doesn't really need a story.
Well, then you would also say that Airplane could have thrown in anything it wanted to. Airplane was very good because it parodied one specific kind of film. I'm just saying this would have been better when they cut away for 5 different rock numbers, it seems like. And I'll take you to see the movie and show you each one of those when you know, when he starts singing.
Yeah.
Those
rock numbers are not supposed to appeal to today's teenagers, Gene. For example, when he was singing Tutti Frutti, that's Pat Boone hit from 1954.
Right.
It was supposed to be satirical.
I think somebody sang it a lot. It wasn't Pat Boone. But my point is that when they cut away for all those songs, it just slows everything
down. They don't cut away for any songs. When he's singing Tutti Frutti, he's walking on people's tables and chairs and things. I think it's a funnier movie than you think it is. Next at the movies, Albert Finney is a victim of his own hallucinations in John Huston's new film, Under the Volcano.
I say, what's the matter here?
Nothing. Absolutely all right.
All right? You were lying down in the middle of the road.
All right, just the same. Thank you.
Difficult novels of the 20th century, Malcolm Lowry's Under the Volcano. It tells the story of a long day in the life of an alcoholic British diplomat who's going to pieces in a Mexican backwater town. The diplomat is played by Albert Finney, and it's a brilliant performance. Instead of stumbling around like some stereotype movie drunk, he successfully gives us an idea of the person that still remains inside that man. Look at this scene where he gathers up his last shreds of dignity after a fellow Englishman finds him passed out in the road.
I say, what's the matter here?
Nothing. Absolutely all right.
All right. You were lying down in the middle of the road.
All right, just the same. Thank you very much.
I dare tell you, we're lying right down here, and I might have run you over. Are you sure there's nothing wrong? Huh? Are you sure you're all right? Haven't I seen you somewhere before?
Oxford?
No, Cambridge.
You're wearing an Oxford tie.
Oh, no, the tie. No, that belongs to my cousin, as a matter of fact. We're headed for Guatemala. We're making a little tour of the temples, don't you know? Splendid country, isn't it?
Splendid.
Look, are you absolutely sure there are no bones broken?
No bones broken.
My dear fellow. Now, listen. We are staying at the Bella Vista. Now, why don't we pop back to the hotel and you can have a little bit of a lie down?
No, fine.
Well, I always keep something in the car for emergencies. Irish. Burke's Irish.
Thanks a million.
No, carry on, my dear fellow. Carry on.
Awfully decent of you, old chap.
There's just nothing quite like the British. The novel Under the Volcano took place almost entirely within the mind of that drunken Englishman. But for his film version, John Huston makes an interesting choice in this film. Instead of trying to picture all the nightmares inside the head of his hero with a lot of hallucinatory visions and fantasies, he asks Albert Finney to suggest them in his eyes, in his voice, and in the pauses in his speech. And one of the best scenes in the movie is the scene where Finney's wife, Jacqueline Bisset, comes back. Now, she has left him and gone to New York, and then suddenly there she is in the doorway, and he turns and looks at her and looks back again. He has to look four times before he can convince himself that she's really there and not just an hallucination. It's really good acting. Under the Volcano takes place in the last days before World War II, and it's the portrait of a man coming apart in a world that's also going to pieces. It's great work by Finney, and another good film in John Huston's extraordinary directing career.
I think it is great work by Finney, and I think that's the very best part of this film. I think the film is less successful in terms of anticipating what's going to happen in the world. But I think in terms of Finney, and I think Huston gets the credit for staying on Finney. This film doesn't back off. You expect to see less of a drunk performance. It keeps coming back and back. You expect there to be more action away from Finney. It comes back to Finney until I think this film really forces us to look at this man and this problem, and then we really start to feel sad. Sad that this relationship with Bisset isn't going to be healed. And we wonder, why can't people change? Why can't they turn it back? I guess too much pain has passed between them, and there will be no coming together.
I kind of agree with you that it doesn't really get into the same sort of thing.
Right.
The novel gets into the fact that this man's life mirrors the fact that World War II is coming, and the Nazis are down in Mexico and so forth. That's in the novel. It would have been really complicated to get it into a two-hour movie, and so by making it a character study of Finney and of this interesting relationship in a real good performance by Jackie Bisset, it's a good movie.
I think so, too. Coming up next at the movies, our special X-ray segment will examine that proposed new change in the movie rating system. Our X-ray subject this week, the proposed change in the movie rating system. And that proposed change is a new fifth category called PG-13 that would come right between PG and R and prohibit youngsters under the age of 13 from seeing certain kinds of violent films. I think the proposed change makes sense in one way and is naive in another. What makes sense is that we do need another category because the PG category, all ages admitted, parental guidance suggested, has become too large and too vague. Indiana Jones and the Temple of Doom was rated PG, and you can see a man rip another man's heart right out of his chest. Gremlins was rated PG, and you can see a little gremlin cut up in a food processor, and another exploded in a microwave oven, and you can see an old lady rocketed to her death. All of this in PG films. You can also hear virtually every obscenity in a PG film, and there may be flashes of female nudity in a PG film. And the level of violence can get incredibly intense, as in the rock musical, Streets of Fire. So I think the proposed new rating between PG and R will help parents realize that such a film is not innocent fluff, that there may be things in the film that you may not want your little ones to see. However, and this is a big however, I think it is a mistake to believe that any theater manager is going to enforce PG-13 and tell 12-year-olds, hey, you can't come in and see the latest Indiana Jones film unless an adult is with you, and I want to see your library card to find out how old you are. Why am I so sure about this? Because right now, the R rating isn't enforced well in most theaters, and if theater owners aren't stopping 14 and 15 and 16-year-olds from seeing R-rated films, they're certainly not going to stop 11 and 12-year-olds from seeing PG-13 films. My suggestion, I just make the category advisory and not compulsory and leave it at that. It's just a piece of information for parents to use any way they want.
I'm in total agreement with you, Gene, and I think that what's happened this summer, and it really started a couple years ago with Poltergeist, is that a lot of parents have taken 7- and 8-year-olds to PG movies, and these movies are really intense, and they're really strong experiences. I think we're not talking so much here about really about nudity or about four-letter words as we are about scenes like that heart being ripped out of the chest in Indiana Jones, that even Steven Spielberg said, who directed the film, if I were sitting next to a 10-year-old, I'd cover the eyes during that scene. So that what's going to happen is a lot of parents have complained all this summer and before, these movies are too intense for my kids, I want a different rating. Now you're going to get, starting in August or September, millions of parents saying, my 13-year-old or my 12-year-old daughter is reading War and Peace. You mean I have to go with her to see Gremlins? So they're going to complain about that. I agree. It ought to be just an advisory informational reading.
Yeah. I don't know how many 12-year-olds are reading War and Peace, but I'll
tell
you.
Okay, well, then in that case, the Muppets Take Manhattan.
Yeah, okay. I think that the people are concerned about language. I get that an awful lot. People are surprised at how much obscenities you can have in a PG film, film. And this PG-13 would be another flag on that matter, too. Mm-hmm. But again, advisory. Don't make the theater owner do a job that he isn't going to do in the first place.
I agree with you. Now let's take another look at the movies that we reviewed on this show. We had a split decision on Conan the Destroyer. I liked the movies High Spirits and Sword and Sorcery Adventure. Gene missed a strong relationship between Conan and a woman. Two thumbs up, though, for Top Secret, the goofy new comedy by the makers of Airplane. It's wall-to-wall with laughs, and I think I liked it even more than Gene did. And two more thumbs up for John Huston's powerful drama, Under the Volcano, with a great performance by Albert Finney as a drunk stumbling through a Mexican nightmare. And so I recommend all three films.
You're a generous man. Under the Volcano and Top Secret for me. That's it for this week. Next time, we'll be reviewing more new movies, including the third Muppets film called The Muppets Take Manhattan and Bachelor Party, which is about the animal house of bachelor parties. That's next time, and until then, we'll see you at the movies.
Pan American, whether it's business or pleasure or a little bit of both across the country and around the world, Pan Am, you can't beat the experience. America's favorite movie candies are coming home. Now enjoy Raisinets, Goobers, and Snowcaps at home and at the movies, star attractions for your movie time pleasure. New AutoFresh flow-through car air freshener attaches to your air vent and circulates freshness throughout your car. Another fresh new idea from Johnson Wax.